Live from the studios of the WBCR radio station, you're listening to Beyond the Box Score. Welcome back, folks, to a new episode of Beyond the Box Score here for Monday, November the 20th, 2023. My name is Sean, and joining here to my right is Mr. Max Schuss. Max, how you doing?
What's going on, man?
How you been?
Had a great weekend.
Where'd you go?
I went to Columbus, Ohio to watch the Ohio State Buckeyes absolutely obliterate the Minnesota Gopher. What is their team? I don't even know.
Not even sure.
I think it's Gophers. It's some horrible name. But yeah, it was a great trip. This was my first college football game that I've ever been to.
Nice.
Yeah, it was a good time. The atmosphere was great. The crowd was super into it. Now, this is the week before the big college football game, Ohio State and Michigan.
Right.
So I think everyone's mind was kind of on that game. But this game was still so much fun. You know, we got to see Marvin Harrison Jr. touchdown, arguably the best college football player on the planet right now. Got to see a couple takeaways. We missed like the play of the game. It was the first play of the second half. It was like a 70 something yard touchdown run by Trevion Henderson, and I completely missed it because I thought I wasn't gonna miss anything. I just went to the concession stand to get some nachos, but literally the first play of the second half. Can you believe that?
That'll happen to me too.
Yeah,
like it's some big play and you miss it, but when you're sitting there the whole time, nothing happens. And then
the second
you get up, it's something, the biggest thing of the game happens.
Yeah, very unfortunate, but it's all right. It was still a great time. They did the marching band was fantastic. I don't know if you know what like Script Ohio is.
Yes.
Yeah, so they did that. That was super cool to see. Where Frank, they have the marching band make like these formations out of all the people. Yeah, so they wrote like Ohio. The halftime performance was great, where it was like Elvis themed, so they play a bunch of Elvis songs and did like these different crazy formations. Yeah, it was a lot of fun. Glad I went and experienced that, because I've gone to NFL games but never a college football game. So I feel like it's different too.
Yeah, you know? I've been to one NFL game. I've never been to a college football game.
Yeah,
it just seems like a different atmosphere, and honestly, the same for any college sport. It just seems more like connected. Like the people are more invested.
It's a younger audience. Yes. Like all these kids are on campus,
right.
And especially in Columbus, Ohio. Ohio State's the number one team in the country right now. Like everyone there in that city are diehard Buckeye fans. Like just walking around after the game, everyone was in the scarlet and silver. You know, it's hard to describe being that. It's like. Imagine everyone in New York City walking around in like Giants and Jets gear. Like
exactly. Great, and it's not just like town. And it's not just like the college students or fans of the college football team. It's people that don't go to the school that just are invested because they watch every week.
Yeah.
And they're invested in the team. So that's like interesting to see you like, I don't know, just college is just, like I said, more interconnected. It's more personable, I feel like, as opposed to like if you go to like Madison Square Garden or Barclays Center to watch the Knicks or Nets play. It just has a different, more connected feel. But Frank, how you doing, my man?
Doing all right, Sean. Hope you guys are doing okay too. We have a lot going on in the world of sports. LA Knight defeated Jimmy Uso, but it didn't end there because, of course, Solo came in and took over, and then another WWE superstar stepped in, and well, he vowed to repel the bloodline.
Dude, I wish I watched WWE so I could know what anything of that meant.
I hear you. Phone lines are open, 718-951-4444. We're gonna send things back to Sean and Max. So guys,
thank you, Frank. Hopefully people call in soon. Max, let's open with the NFL, and I know we usually cover breakdown specific games, but let's take a different spin on it. Let's talk about teams that have lost their starting quarterback, and let's break down what's next for them. So of the teams that have lost their quarterback, which one is the most significant to you?
Significant to me? I mean, it's got to be the Browns, right? 7-3 on the season. They are in the perfect spot to secure a playoff position. But Deshaun Watson, out for the remainder of the season with a shoulder injury. They signed Joe Flacco over the weekend. but right. It was rookie Dorian Thompson-Robinson who led the Browns to a 13-10 victory over the Steelers this weekend. How much attention did you pay for this game?
Not much.
It was a bit of a snooze fest, I'm not going to lie. But the Browns have, if not, they have one of the best defenses in the entire NFL this season. Myles Garrett, another 2 sacks.
All right.
Yesterday, that's 13 on the season, leading the league in that category. And I think in my mind, probably your mind, probably everyone's mind, he is the front runner for Defensive Player of the Year.
Easily.
Yeah. So, you know what? 7-3 on the season, they, like the Jets, have a recipe to winning games now where their starting quarterback is down, mm-hmm. but they have an amazing defense. So right. if you can just grind it out, keep it in those one possession games, you really never know what's going to happen.
And this is the same thing we said when Aaron Rodgers went down. It's the defense that's going to hold this team together.
Yeah.
Now, for the Jets, Zach Wilson has been completely awful. We'll get to him soon. But if the Browns are able to, the defense will hold down. But if they're able to find some recipe of consistent offense that gets them good drives, gets them runs down the field to put them in opportunities in the end zone to score, I still feel like this team has the potential to still be where they are, to stay consistent.
Yeah, and you know they got Mari Cooper. They have weapons on offense. So if this kid Thompson Robinson can, you know, maybe build some chemistry, maybe they could make some noise in the playoffs. But I doubt, you know, if they're really gonna have much of a stretch there.
Exactly. Like there's only so much you could do with the rookie quarterback.
Yeah.
Even as good as the team is outside the quarterback position. So right now they're positioned to be firmly in the playoffs, or is it the wild card that they're?
Right now, they are behind the Ravens in the division right now.
Yes. What about the Minnesota Vikings, Joshua Dobbs?
Okay, so we've had a lot of fantastic stories in the NFL this season, but I don't know if any of them are better than Josh Dobbs. I mean, this guy is ridiculous. He was with the Browns and he was with the Titans last season, then. Coming into this season, he was with the Browns in the preseason. Then he gets traded to the Cardinals, where he's shoved in that starting role because of the Kyler Murray injury. Then at the trade deadline, he only wins one game for the Cardinals. But then at the trade deadline, he's traded to the Vikings. Now the Vikings lose Kirk Cousins for the season with the torn ACL. Which is a pretty. It was at the time. It was a very devastating injury. For
when
team.
It happened, it's like he was playing good.
He was playing very good.
He was playing very good this season. And for him to go down, it was like, wow. And for the Vikings, this was a good timing because they lost. what's up, Oscar? They lost Kirk Cousins, and at the same time, the Cardinals got Kyler Murray back.
Yeah.
So it's interesting to see now the Vikings were able to pick up Joshua Dobbs, and it's worked so far. They're still missing Justin Jefferson. I feel like he won't even play. I think they'll bring him back after the bye, probably.
Yeah. So started out 2-0 with Josh Dobbs.
Yeah.
Lost last night in a heartbreaker to the Broncos 20-21, but he put them in position to win that game. It kind of took some Russell Wilson magic, some Cortland Sutton incredible catches for them to pull out that victory, but I've been very impressed with what Josh Dobbs has done. It's just the fact that this guy, he was drafted in 2017. He's been bouncing around different teams, and he's kind of it's really unfair.
He finally got a true opportunity to show what he could do, and now he's proving it. So for the Vikings, I saw an interesting stat where they were like with Justin Jefferson, they were below 500, but with him going into this weekend, they've only lost one game. Without him, they were 4-1 without Justin Jefferson.
Is that right?
Yeah, I was like, that's interesting. Well, now 4-2, but that's interesting. So
he's coming back soon, though. Vikings are 6-5 on the season now. Do you see them making the postseason?
I'm gonna say no, but I could be wrong.
Okay,
I don't think so because there's just so many talented teams ahead of them that have been healthy. Mm-hmm. So I just don't think so. If it is, it's the continue of the miracle story for Joshua Dobbs.
Okay, let's talk about probably the most devastating quarterback injury, Joe Burrow and the Bengals.
Oh, Joe, what a rough one, huh?
Yeah. So Joe Burrow will miss the remainder of the season after tearing a ligament in his right wrist during last Thursday night's 34-20 loss to the Baltimore Ravens. He threw, I think it was a short pass to Joe Mixon, mm-hmm. where you saw him start to wince in pain.
Yeah.
There's currently an investigation going on right now on why he was wearing a
device.
Yeah, like a brace or something
Some
like
sort
that.
Sort of like a brace that the Bengals themselves put out on social media.
Yeah.
On Wednesday, like Joe Burrow like practicing, and it's like
you but put he was not listed.
But you weren't putting him on the injury report, nothing. Yeah. And then you see that shot of him on the sideline trying to throw a ball. He can't even grip it.
Oh, yeah.
He's just grimacing in pain.
Yep.
Once he tries to throw it.
Yeah, so this is Joe Burrow's second season-ending injury of his career. And it's really devastating for that fact, but also because the Bengals were really starting to, you know, hit their stride. They after a tough start to their season, we saw their defense start to play really well. Burrow and Chase, that connection was you know, in full effect. The run game was great.
Absolutely.
They, you know, seemed to be prepping for another postseason run, but now with him down for the season, they've thrusted an undrafted backup, Jake Browning. When he went in for Joe, he went 8 for 14 for 68 yards and a touchdown. But yeah, I mean, without Joe, it's tough to see this team doing anything now.
And this Browning kid, I don't see it. There's so many questions, right? Because what's the offense going to look like now?
Yeah.
Is it just going to all go to Joe Mixon, which is a reliable option? Is Ja'Marr Chase going to get any real looks? Like, that's the biggest question, because you still have offensive pieces.
Yeah.
There's just, what do you do with this new quarterback? Where do the Bengals want to go? Because their season's over.
Mm-hmm.
This isn't going to be a Joshua Dobbs situation where he comes in to save the Vikings after Kirk Cousins goes down. This Browning isn't Dobbs, so I think their season is over. It's just what, for the rest of the season, from now to the rest of the season, what's this offense going to look like?
Mm-hmm. It's the best division in all of football, right?
Yep.
You should say so. Yep. Unless, you know, Browning somehow turns out to be another Brock Purdy, I think it might be over for them.
Hold on. Joining us, 10 minutes late, but it's all right, is Mr. Oscar. What's going on, Oscar?
Hey, what's up, guys? Sorry about that.
That's all good. That's all good. How you been?
Off the bench. Oh, no, I knew you guys could hold down the fort for me in my absence, but I'm doing pretty well, man. Doing pretty well.
That's good.
Had a fun weekend.
Nice. Yeah. So we were going through some teams that have lost their starting quarterback.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And what we see for them the rest of the year, and we're up to the Bengals. So what do you think of Joe Burrow going out for the year, and what do you see for them the remainder of the year?
Yeah, I think it's just going to be, you know, they're just going to basically be The only plus side is they could maybe get a good guy in the draft.
Mm-hmm.
That's really the only bright spot on this season. That's really it, you know, because I've been saying for a while, I think that this offense isn't very good. It's just they at least the way it's structured, they just kind of let, there's like, hey, Joe, like every single play, can you just work out some magic? Mm-hmm. You know, like the play design isn't great. Their play calling isn't very good. It's just like on Ja'Marr Chase and Joe Burrow to just find each other, you know? And without Joe Burrow, that's not really going to work, because most quarterbacks in the world aren't as good as Joe Burrow. So this has been a disastrous year for them. I think they've also done a pretty poor job of looking out for kind of the best thing that's ever happened to this franchise, which is Joe Burrow, which isn't saying that much. It's a pretty low ceiling there. But, you know, that I think they shouldn't have played him in the first few games of the season, because he was playing injured in the first few games. And that's why they were so bad, is because he was clearly playing hurt.
Mm-hmm.
And now he's just hurt himself even more. And this is a guy who, like you already said, Max, this is his second season that's ending early due to injury already in his very young career. That's, you don't want to see that from your entire franchise, basically.
And for Burrow, you look at it like this, right? He came into the season with a calf injury, and they started off poor. They started off 1-3, right? And then everyone was quick to write him off. Oh, Burrow, sir, the Bengals aren't going anywhere. And then they start racking up wins, and it's like, all right, and I'm like, okay, the Bengals are back in the hunt. They're still a playoff team. Mm-hmm. I still believe in them. And now just in a moment's notice, it's over.
Yeah.
It's done.
Like, it's been a really up and down season for Bengals fans. First, you sign him to that historic contract. You have the horrible, you know, injury, the slow start.
Right.
Now a season-ending injury after you start to kind of pick back up that momentum, like you said.
You start building up some momentum, and then right away it's just over suddenly. And Oscar, what do you think, because me and Max briefly mentioned it, what do you think of Joe Burrow having some sort of device on his hand and the Bengals saying nothing about it, because it was floating around social media, him with some sort of like device on his hand for protection.
Yeah, some kind of cast.
Yeah, thing. But the Bengals said nothing about it, nothing on the injury report.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. This is kind of conspiracy theory stuff because we don't really know for sure what's going on there. But I think they just kind of didn't want people to know that he was playing hurt. You know, I think that they've just, you know, they've been pretty, you know, they haven't really taken care of him in the right way. And I think that they didn't really want it to be a bad look for the organization. But it is now because he's out for the season. Not to mention, I think this, I don't know, maybe they bring in a new head coach. I'm not a big fan of Zach Taylor. I feel like this team could be even better than it is.
I was going to bring that up, too, because I don't know if Zach Taylor elevates the team in any sort of way.
I don't think he does. I mean, now we're going to see, especially without Joe Burrow, let's see how this offense looks. Yeah. My prediction is it's not going to look very good, but it might. It's also not going to look great. It's going to probably be a little bit worse next year because T. Higgins is almost certainly gone. Did they sign Ja'Marr Chase yet, or no? Have they not given the money out to? Have they given the bag to Ja'Marr Chase? I don't know. So. I know they gave it to Burrow.
Yeah.
And you know, NFL has very strict cap rules. They would be absolute fools not to sign, you know, Ja'Marr Chase to a contract extension. And like I said, the NFL has really strict cap rules. So that means, and T. Higgins would be a number one wide receiver on most teams in the NFL. So he's almost certainly not staying.
Chase hasn't signed. He could sign in 2024.
Okay.
So yeah,
but I mean, I think they're definitely going to save some cap space to give Chase that contract.
Yeah, you have to, and
yeah.
It's this Bengals offense. If Higgins isn't coming back anytime soon, it's going to be a lot on Mixon to run the ball. It's going to be a lot looking for where Ja'Marr Chase is. Can he get openings? Because If it's not going to Mixon or Chase, who's it going? Who reliably is this going to?
Yeah.
Like who could the Bengals depend on their offense?
Tyler to carry Boyd, them? Maybe dropping another touchdown.
But he's another like hit or miss week in week out.
I think,
but that, maybe.
Yeah. I mean, it really helps all the other receivers just that Joe Burrow has that many options. You know, the other defenses have to do a lot of work to try and keep all those guys quiet. I mean, but hey, maybe. Maybe they get a high draft pick. I don't think they're going to be bad enough to get, you know, a top five pick or anything like that. But, you know, you never know. This is kind of how they got Ja'Marr Chase in the first place. They were bad. Joe Burrow got hurt, got injured, and then they were bad enough to where they got to pick Ja'Marr Chase.
Right. Why don't we transition to the Giants? Because I have some stuff to say.
Go. I guess they won yesterday, but this is still a rough situation. Go ahead.
Yeah, so you lost Daniel Jones for the season from a torn ACL. In comes Tyrod Taylor, suffers that rib injury, not out for the rest of the season, but then in comes Tommy DeVito, an undrafted rookie. He made his starting debut in Dallas where they lost 49-17. I'm not going to put anything on him for that. You know, that's an incredibly tough like atmosphere, place to play, especially against that defense. However, yesterday... How about this? I don't think anyone, you know, coming into the season, would you guys agree that you thought the Giants were the worst team in the NFL?
No, they were in my mind.
I thought the Bears were worse.
No.
The Bears?
Yeah.
With Justin Fields.
I thought going to the season, the Cardinals were going to be the worst team.
Okay, we're talking about like going into this this weekend.
Oh, going into this weekend. Yeah. Oh, I'm so sorry.
Weekend. They were up there probably.
There's a few bad teams, but they're definitely like top three. Bottom three.
This was a shocker to me. I mean, the Giants beat the Washington Commanders in Washington, 31-19. Giants had six takeaways, and DeVito played great. You know, 18 for 26, 246 yards, 3 touchdowns, 0 interceptions, with 137.7 passer rating. Great numbers, and he played very well considering the fact that he was under pressure the entire game. I mean, Commanders sacked him 9 times and they still won. So, my question for you guys is what do you see the Giants being here on out? Because you know the season is lost at this point, 3-8 record. Are there any like big takeaways that you could see the Giants having like moving forward? You know, I mean, they have Kayvon Thibodeau's having a great season. I think he's got like 10.5 sacks on the season. Saquon Barkley had a great game yesterday. Mm-hmm. He's proved to them and to Giants fans that I think he wants to stay there long term. So I don't know. What do you guys see the Giants being for the rest of the season?
I see them maybe winning one or two games.
Okay.
And honestly, that's about it.
Okay.
What they need to do is get a high draft pick and draft another quarterback.
Okay, yeah. I was going to ask you that.
Yeah, because yeah. Daniel Jones, and I feel like we've kind of known it going into the season, he was decent to good last year and then did this season just nothing replicating what he did last year. And I don't think they could trust him. I mean, they trusted enough to give him $40 million mm-hmm. for some reason, but
yeah.
I don't feel like you could trust him to be the quarterback that could carry your franchise.
Yeah.
No, definitely not. I think it was a huge mistake giving him that giant deal. Yeah, I mean, the only thing you really can do is hope for the best. You know, maybe you hope you beat like a rival team. I mean, it's too late for the Cowboys. The Cowboys swept them, right? Yeah,
they beat them twice.
Swept them. Have they played the Eagles twice?
They played the Eagles.
They played the Eagles once.
Okay,
so and the Eagles beat them.
Maybe you know, you just go all in for that game, try and win, beat the Eagles or something.
Yeah, good luck
with that. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think in all seriousness, okay, I'll stop joking now. Sorry, Giants fans. In all seriousness, man, I think it's just you got to tear it down. You got to rebuild. You got to just.
They haven't played the Eagles yet. So they play the Patriots, Packers, Saints in their next three.
They're playing the Giants on Christmas Day.
If DeVito kind of plays well, I can see them winning all three of those games.
We'll see.
Wait, list those games off again?
Patriots, Packers, Saints.
I mean,
they could beat the Patriots. I don't know about the Saints, but they could beat the Packers and the Patriots.
I mean, it's just, hey, look, the way the NFL and most American sports are structured, the unfortunate thing is if you're a Giants fan, you kind of want this team to lose. Because,
yeah.
I mean,
that Patriots and Giants game next weekend is going to be.
Oof, yeah, I think you got to trade a lot of your assets and just, you know, if you get a top two pick, you know, I know a lot of people like, who's the North Carolina guy? May?
Drake May.
Yeah. And there's Caleb Williams, of course, for USC. If you can get one of those guys, I say go for it, man.
It is a stacked quarterback draft. Is,
yeah. You'll need to go after a quarterback here.
You got some good guys there. Yeah.
You really think they're going to do it after signing Daniel Jones for that contract?
I just
they should.
What else
because
can you do?
Like, if you bring him back next year, what does it do for you? It's like
when you sign him, you give him $40 million a year. That shows that you're committed to him. So, less than a year later, going out and selecting a quarterback after signing him to that contract, it's not a great look for that front office, you know?
Oh, no.
What was his injury? Was it an ACL?
It was ACL. Yeah.
How is it going to be coming back from an ACL next season?
Yeah, that's the other thing. On his athleticism.
Yeah.
And it sucks, too, because I think if Tyrod Taylor was still in, they could definitely win some games and
yeah, I don't know why they took out Tyrod Taylor.
Maybe be in the hunt for a wild card spot, but like, I don't know. It's
gonna be a lot of reliance on Saquon.
Yeah,
and basically praying that Saquon saves your offense.
Mm-hmm. And it sucks too because Giants, like, you know, they're always that frisky team where they have pieces. You know, I like their coach. Obviously, love Saquon, Dexter Lawrence, like Andrew Thomas. They have guys who can definitely play and contribute, but they can never just kind of string those wins together. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's just, you play in a division that has the Cowboys and the Eagles, and I think both of those teams have at least two more seasons of being good, you know, before you can really think about them declining. So I you're not winning that division. I don't care if you're the Giants.
No.
I think it's just, man, it's just let the Eagles and the Cowboys kind of have their
let them do what I'll
I hate to advocate for tanking, like I really do, but that's kind of all you can do, you know. You got to just let this Daniel Jones contract wind down, and you just got to in the meantime, you know, you got to try and find a new young quarterback, because the Giants need to get real. They got lucky getting in the playoffs last year. I think they just need to say, hey, we got to stop just trying to throw like spaghetti at the wall and seeing what sticks. You know, you just it's time to, you know, I'd say send all the scouts out to look at these quarterbacks, say identify which one you want the most, get aggressive, maybe trade a Saquon, who it doesn't seem like they want to give him the contract. So maybe trade the guy, you know, get another first round pick, like a couple second round picks, something like that.
Did you say spaghetti because of Tommy DeVito?
Oh no, I didn't. I didn't because the usual word that you use in that phrase is a curse word. I will say about Tommy DeVito though, he already has more more games with multiple touchdown passes than Kenny Pickett does.
Really?
Yeah. If I'm not mistaken.
Kenny Pickett something.
This is funny. I forget which show it was, but someone was previewing the Browns Steelers game, and they're like, well, if you're the Browns, you're in there with your backup quarterback. But I was like, yeah, if you're the Steelers, then your starting quarterback is a backup quarterback.
Do you guys want to move on to the Jets?
Let's do it.
Yeah, sounds
good. Yeah. Was this the last week that we saw Zach Wilson as starting QB?
It really might be.
What a disaster yesterday was.
Yeah, so Jets bench Zach in a 29-6 loss. Was that the final score?
29-6.
They put in Tim Boyle as their quarterback. I'm pretty sure
32-6. Sorry,
32-6.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh yeah, they scored a field goal.
Yes.
After the game, Saleh would not confirm or deny if Zach was going to be their starting quarterback.
But he knows
the rest of the season. I think we all know what the answer should be, you know? They're not getting anywhere with Zach running this offense. I mean, did you guys see the clip of him going out there and, like, tripping on nothing and falling on his ass?
Yes.
I mean, that's just kind of...
Like, he literally got sacked by his own body movement.
Yeah.
Like, literally.
Yeah. That's kind of just the picture-perfect moment to describe this Jets season and kind of Zach Wilson's career. And I hate to shit on the guy... hate to poop on the guy, you know, because... He's a young player, and he gets a lot of crap from the New York media. But you can't say it's not deserved. I mean, he has an incredibly talented team around him, and he's just not producing. So I think the right move here is to bench Zach moving forward. What do you guys think?
I agree. I think just the whole Zach Wilson situation this season, I think it's an indictment on the front office. First and foremost, you signed – a 39-year-old quarterback, even though he is a legend, he's a 39-year-old. He's a 39-year-old QB. You can't expect him to be healthy the whole year. You just can't. This is the most brutal sport in maybe the whole world. It's a violent, violent game. You can't. You should have. And my point is, I'm sorry, I'm going on for a little while, but my point is, you should have brought in somebody. You should have brought in a backup who wasn't Zach Wilson. You know, the kid can't play, man. Like, I hate to say this. It feels like we're just bullying him on the internet at this point. Hey, but it's just like he can't play.
Jameis Winston would have been a much better option.
That's what I'm as soon as Rodgers went down, you should have went to the trade market. Even before that, even before the season, like, you might as well have just kept White Mike.
Mike White. Mike White. But
I call him White Mike because that's the name of a character in The Wire.
Remember the whole Jets thing that they did? What's that HBO series called?
Hard Knocks.
Hard Knocks, and they specifically so many times showed Aaron Rodgers working with Zach Wilson, and all they filmed was every time Zach Wilson made a perfect throw. Maybe a little struggles, but then you just see him overcome it. And I feel like you were purposely doing that to show, like, hey, Aaron Rodgers is great, but, you know, we have this guy, Zach Wilson, who's really good, and people just don't know it yet. And all this guy has done is fall flat on his face in this NFL season.
Yeah.
And I think it's not working.
Yeah, I've heard some people, even some people, like, around the WBCR studios be like, well, you know, like, Aaron's going to teach Zach. I'm like, teach him what, man?
I mean, hey, learning from Aaron Rodgers is a good thing, but...
I actually agree with them that, though. Like, if he was able to just sit and watch Aaron, you know, for the remainder of the season, for the entirety of the season, really, I think that would have done a lot for Zach.
But is Aaron Rodgers going to teach him how to grow, like, 3 inches and not be so tiny and, like, have a stronger arm and be able to, like, throw... I don't know.
No. Oscar, it's okay. Aaron Rodgers is going to be back by January and he's going to adjust to the playoffs.
So, actually, according to Jay Glazer, quarterback Aaron Rodgers sent a video to the team this week of him working out, and it, quote, blew their minds. Okay. He has told them he wants to start practicing as early as December 2nd.
Wow.
What is this guy on?
They keep every single week now. It's literally just different little...
It's just, because the Jets are awful, and they're like, oh, this is the only way to keep people talking about the Jets. He's not coming back.
Yeah.
And if he comes back, and if the Jets, okay, if the Jets medical staff let him come back and he gets hurt again, that's bad.
Yeah, they'd be doing a disservice by letting him come back this early.
He's, next season, he's and honestly, he will play football again. He's probably coming back next year, and he's going to be 40. So he's not. There's no way they're going to let him rush this injury, especially when they're not having good starts. If they were clicking and they were good, if they were above 500, they'll be like, all right, we put Aaron Rodgers, bring him back for a playoff run. Okay, but this team's not making the playoffs with Zach Wilson.
No.
No.
Is there anything else that you guys want to touch on before we go to the phones?
I think it might be a tough one with Aaron Rodgers next year because we have no idea how good he's going to be coming back. Yeah. I mean, he's definitely...
He's going to want to come back.
Yeah, for sure. He's going to be better than Zach Wilson. I forget how much longer his contract is, but I want to say it's like at least two more seasons.
For Rodgers, yeah.
Yeah.
Two more.
So it's just kind of tough.
It's not. I don't think he's going to be 100%.
Oh, No.
I mean, I was an advocate for them maybe trying to see what's good in the trade market. If the Cardinals put Kyler Murray on the auction block, I thought someone should go get him, but it doesn't seem like they're going to.
No.
It seems like he's playing, and they're like, okay,
we're going to. Absolutely. Is there anything else you guys want to touch on about the Jets or any other teams we covered?
No, I think we can move on.
You good? All right, and waiting on the phone line is a very happy Jets fan this afternoon, Daniel from Diker Heights. What's going on, Daniel?
I hate this. I hate it here. No. All right, what's going on, guys? How you doing?
What's going on, right, man? How you doing today, man?
Look, it's a very simple solution. You cut Zach Wilson. Don't even put him on the bench. Don't even give him a book to read. Put him on the streets, all right? I don't care that he's a kid. I don't care if we're bullying him. He's got to go. When you're not an NFL quarterback, you got to be on the streets, okay? If anything, he might be looking for a LinkedIn profile to build because the guy can't do it anymore. I mean, I'm over it. I mean, as Jet fans, we're over it. You know, Robert Saleh just announced they're going to start Tim Boyle on Friday, so thank God. So Zach's going to be on the bench. But
they
just
revealed that?
Wait, they're going to start him next week?
Yeah, confirmed.
Okay.
Okay.
Oh, wow. All right.
What is your reaction to that, man? They finally kind of, you know, had their last straw.
It's about damn time.
Yeah.
Okay? It's maybe 3 weeks too late because, I mean, I go back thinking about it now. The point of the season where I realized he's not ready and he's not going to be a successful quarterback was when he dropped the ball on Sunday night against Kansas City. Because they were driving, they were going to win that game, they were going to score a touchdown, they had all the momentum, and he drops the freaking ball.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that was the moment where he should have been benched, because he was okay, but not good, and he almost beat one of the best teams in the league.
Yeah,
and you could show me the Philly game over and over again. Did he win that game for the team? No, he didn't.
No,
that was the defense.
Okay? So to my... We went as Jet fans, we've been sold the biggest jar of snake oil by Joe Douglas and Robert Saleh.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Zach Wilson has never been a good quarterback, and it's another wasted season.
He looks and like he should have like a podcast on Barstool.
Oscar, they should have done something in the trading deadline. Josh Dobbs was out there. Jameis Winston was out there. Mm-hmm. And it's not like you were going to get... You had to give a Ferrari for them. You could have gone for a bag of nuts.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, as a Jet fan, it's frustrating. It's so frustrating. And you get a guy like Danny DeVito who just balls out against Commanders and has no problem throwing the ball. Mm-hmm. And Zach Wilson can barely throw a 5-yard slant. It makes no sense.
I mean, if you look at Tommy DeVito and Zach Wilson, I mean, they're two in the same, you know? And I'll throw Mac Jones in there. All three of them are whatever. But for Zach Wilson, yeah, it's over. I obviously don't think they're going to cut him, but I don't think he's going to start again this season. And next season's going to be interesting to see what they do. If Rodgers is, in fact, ready to come back, what do you do with Zach Wilson?
I cut him. I mean, I'm being serious. I'm done. I think the experiment has to be over.
It's over.
All right? Mm.
I think Joe Flacco would be better.
Oscar, I agree with you. He ain't teaching Zach crap. He could have told Jordan Love how to throw a football, and he didn't want to do it. He didn't want somebody to come after his job. He's not going to teach Zach. Nobody wanted to teach Zach. Joe Flacco came in, and he didn't teach him anything.
Yeah, I mean,
unless he didn't, the guy didn't learn anything.
Yeah, what can you teach him? He shouldn't even be here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Yeah, I don't know. I think from the summer, I think they... I mean, like I was just saying earlier in the show, I think they would have done better with Mike White. Like, even no, he would have been fun.
Dude, if Mike White was on this team, he would throw 300-plus yards a game.
Yeah, no. Mike White is better than Zach Wilson.
It's also seems like the whole, I don't know, I don't watch the Jets every single week, like every, you know, play.
Lucky but, you.
But it seems like, I don't know, it just seems like the whole team just kind of resents having Zach Wilson there.
But it's been like this since last year.
Yeah.
There's a different vibe in the locker room when he's quarterbacking. The guys they don't feel right with him there. You see it on the field, too. Their body language is terrible. They look dejected. And the defense is probably pissed off because they're on the field half the time.
Yeah. Bro, you could tell the locker room is definitely out on them. And I feel so bad for two things. I feel so bad for that Jets defensive line. Because they're nice, and if they had a reliable offense to go with it, they'd be a really good team. And another guy I feel bad for is Garrett Wilson, because what a waste of a season this was for him. Mm-hmm. Because
and like you have to play, the offensive line is not great, but when your quarterback's holding the ball for 5 seconds, you're not blocking for 5 seconds, so of course you're going to seem terrible.
Let me
ask you this: every week now, we're hearing news about Rodgers and his potential comeback. Are you kind of sick of those stories?
I'm not sick of it. I'm more of let's see and believe it, because I think we're going to get smoked by Miami this week.
Mm-hmm.
But then, you know, we have kind of a lighter half of the schedule. And this is me being a delusional Jeff fan, because I need to be to keep my sanity insane. But there is a chance here where they could come back and pull off some nice wins here.
Okay, so it gives you hope.
Sorry?
The stories of Rodgers and his injury recovery gives you hope.
It gives me hope. I need to see it to believe it. I can only hear so much. I see him out there dropping back, mm-hmm. taking a hit to his legs, and then standing up again, throwing the football again, then I'll say, yeah, he's my quarterback.
He's back, but yeah, okay.
At this point, I would keep him on the bench. I would keep him till he's fully healthy, because even if he comes back and he's 60%, and he gets hurt again, we have no quarterback.
Mm-hmm.
And at this point, because if you bring Aaron Rodgers back and this team has some momentum, it's like, all right, if we bring Aaron back, it could all come together for the playoffs. What are you bringing him back for? This seems awful. Like, this team has no playoff hopes.
I don't believe
as
that.
Even a slight chance.
This team is not awful, okay? You have the offensive rookie of the year on the wideout. Okay, you have a very solid receiver now in the Zard. You have an okay offensive line. You're probably one of the top five defenses in the league. This offense needs to put up 17 points a game, and we win every single game.
Mm-hmm,
this is not a bad Jet team. This is not an overall terrible team. It's a solid football team with a Division III quarterback.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. All right. Interesting.
Yeah, no, I think that... Yeah, no, it's tough. It's a tough time for Jets fans, because you can see the talent and quality all around the team. It's just, you know, quarterback's a burger.
But it's been like this for so long.
They're in the QB purgatory, man. It's really the QB away purgatory, as I like to call it, which means
they really are a QB away.
Because you'll never be bad enough to, you know, get a high enough draft pick to get like a franchise QB in the draft, but you're also not, you know, good enough to win a Super Bowl. It's really tough.
Just think of the quarterbacks after Mark Sanchez. Okay, you had Geno Smith, who was supposed to come here and be the savior. You had Sam Darnold to come here and be the savior, and then you had Zach Wilson.
Mm-hmm.
And which one worked out?
Oh, none of them.
No.
I mean, you had Fitzmagic for you.
We've had 8 years of pure purgatory and misery, of just no future.
Do you think you have it worse or Chargers fans?
Oh, we have it worse, 100%.
Well, because
they have a quarterback, Max. Come on.
I know, but they just lose in the most devastating ways possible.
They lose in the playoffs. We don't even make it to the playoffs.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, if you're the Chargers, you at least have a solid quarterback. You have one of the best running backs in the league, so there's something to build off there. Like, if you look at the Jets team, like, there's offensive options, but not to the level of what the Chargers have. Yes, people all the time say the Chargers have names, but they're good players.
But the key is that they have a quarterback who can throw the football.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's just a shame. It's just a shame. Like, we just really don't know how Aaron Rodgers is going to come back next year. I don't think he's good. I don't think he's done. But, you know, I don't know. I think you're going to need to upgrade that offensive line in the offseason through the draft, something like that, you know, because he's going to need protection next year.
Mm-hmm.
I agree, but I also think part of it, too, is that Rodgers gets the ball out of his hands a lot faster than Zach Wilson does, which is going to help the line. And I think when the offensive line is healthy, it's solid.
Right.
And I'm not talking about Mekhi Becton, I'm talking about the other four guys on the line, because they're all solid, because Mekhi Becton, I'm done with him too. But I feel like the pieces are there, and if Rodgers can be 50% of what he was in Green Bay, this is a 500 team.
Yeah, definitely.
Jets play the Dolphins twice. They play the Texans. They play the Browns. It's a tough sledding for the rest of the season for the Jets.
It's tough, but those are games that you could say are winnable.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Other than the Miami game, because I think Miami, it's going to come full circle on Friday, because we're going to get blown out by 30 at home, and then here comes Mike White with another 20, and we're going to lose 50-0.
Oh, boy.
She was going to throw 300, and then Mike's going to throw 300. So it's going to be a 600 passing yard game for the Dolphins without Tyreek Hill. That's going
to
be fun.
I'm sorry, Daniel. I got one of my best buddies is a Jets fan, and he just vents to me every Sunday. So I wish I could feel what you're going through right now, but I'm sorry, man.
Hey, Daniel's a real soldier, calling in every week to talk about this for like 5 minutes plus, and he has his own show.
Look. At this point, you're just hoping for next season, Aaron Rodgers coming back.
But that's every season.
We still have nice options, the defense. So there's hope, I guess. But we'll see.
We've wasted 8 seasons in a row. I've wasted 8 years of my life with this team. Anyone who wants to call me a Fugazi fan, I dare them.
I don't think anyone would, man. Yeah, no.
At least you have the Rangers and Knicks that are solid.
Don't even start on the Mets either.
Don't bring up the Mets.
Yeah, I wouldn't talk about
the
Mets.
I'm sick
either.
And tired of being the loser, the losing team.
Daniel, is there anything else you want to touch on with the Jets or anything else?
No, I think I'm okay now. I think I got everything.
Definitely
all right.
Got your point.
You got other teams you like. Knicks are all right. Rangers are all right. Aren't like Juve are like second.
Talk about them. So we have to talk about the Jets.
Okay, let's do it.
Nobody cares
Knicks,
about hockey but me.
Wait. Let's do it. Knicks Timberwolves tonight, right? That's gonna be a great game. Who do you have?
I'll take the Knicks because we're rolling right now, and Minnesota's in shambles. So
Minnesota's in shambles.
Number one in the West is in shambles.
That locker room must be in shambles, though, man. Because if you're I don't want to get off topic too much.
Yeah, as long as Rudy Gobert doesn't get choked out again.
Well, that's what I'm saying, man, because that locker room must be an awkward place, man, because all I'm saying is there were like 7 Warriors all around Draymond when he was choking Rudy Gobert out, and I didn't see a single Timberwolf come
Cat
to
was
help.
There, but he was like...
Cat was
like,
what's Cat going to do?
He was just like, okay, you can finish.
He was like, I don't really like him either,
Towns is a walkover.
I didn't realize that that people hated Rudy that much,
They've had beef for a while.
Because I just thought that respect him.
It's Gobert and Draymond that have... Gobert and Draymond that have beef for a while.
Maybe he's like, you shut down the
We were
the
supposed
league.
To talk about the Knicks, and now we're just going on about the Timberwolves. Sorry about that.
So Knicks and Timberwolves, what do you think is going to happen tonight?
I think that... I think the Knicks are starting to get into a groove now. They're starting to play better basketball, and they're starting to get the system going again. If Dante DiVincenzo is the key to this team, if he could come out and put 20 points up every night off the bench or starting, this team's going to win games. So that's what we need from – that's what we signed him to do. Josh Hart's going to do his thing. Brunson's going to do his thing. Randall's going to be Randall, but the key is DiVincenzo, because you need that secondary scoring from this team, because it's not going to come from anywhere else.
And RJ came back Saturday, so you guys have him back. I mean, this and Mitchell Robinson has been good on the boards. So this team's good.
This team is good. I still think that we're a star away. I don't think we're going anywhere with this roster. But I think right now they're starting to gel a little bit, and they're starting to get back into their groove. So I mean, it's still early. I'm not gonna sit here and say the season's over,
or it's not.
I think we're still in a position where we can grow.
Yeah,
and I think it comes down to how good this bench actually is.
If he plays well, we got to get you a DiVincenzo jersey, man.
look, man, he's got. If he starts becoming a real Italian, then maybe we'll talk about it.
Daniel, one more question for you before you go.
Absolutely.
Which New York sports team do you think is going to win a championship next?
Oh, that's a good question.
Good question.
I mean, right now, I have to say the Rangers.
Mm-hmm. That's a good pick. Yeah, no, that's a good pick.
I think they have probably the best team in New York right now. They have the most star power. They have one of the better coaches, and they're playing the best out of all the teams right now.
Hold on, Daniel. Max asked what next New York team, right?
Yeah.
Would you count the Nets in that?
The Nets?
Yeah, I would.
Oh, my God. No.
And the Nets are not winning a championship anytime soon.
They're not winning a championship, but I consider them a New York team.
Brooklyn.
They're still a jersey.
Brooklyn,
team.
No. They're Brooklyn still a jersey Nets.
Team.
Brooklyn Nets.
I don't think New York. What are you talking about?
No. But it'll always be the New Jersey Nets.
Sean, you're a Celtics fan who's never been to Boston.
I've been to Boston.
Oh, no.
But,
oh, boy.
All right. Is there anything else you want to touch on?
What happened?
Anything else you want to talk about?
You're good.
All right, no, I'm good, guys. Sean, you gotta get your crew together, man. They're jumping you.
Hey, man, what's going on here?
All right, thank you, Daniel.
All right, thanks, Daniel. Man. Always love to speak to you.
Always a pleasure. See you, Danny.
Always. Take care, guys.
Happy Thanksgiving.
You too. If I don't see you guys, happy Thanksgiving.
Happy Thanksgiving.
All right, so for the rest of the show here, let's talk about NBA teams that we have an eye out for, mm-hmm. whether it's for good or for bad, right? Max, what NBA team will you be keeping an eye on for the rest of the year?
Okay, so we already touched on it for a little bit, but the team that has my eye right now is the Minnesota Timberwolves.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, they're 6th in net rating, 3rd in defensive rating, 14th in overall in offensive rating, 8-2 in their last 10 games, number 1 in the West. Rudy Gobert and Mr. Carl Anthony Towns are gelling right now. There's nothing I hate about this team. Like I like their coaching. I like their transition offense defense. Anthony Edwards is playing unbelievable right now. This game tonight is going to tell me a lot about this team. Is it in the Garden?
It's in the Minnesota.
Man, okay.
Target Center.
Yeah, let me make sure, but I believe it's in Minnesota.
All right. I want to see him keep winning, man. I mean, you know, it's not necessarily a young team, but it's not an old team either. So just kind of seeing where they play out as the season. Again, it's still very early in the season. I could have picked, you know, Denver. I could have picked the Celtics. I could have went with Milwaukee. Like there are much better teams that I think are going to probably produce some better postseason results. But right now, this team has really shocked.
It's fun.
Yeah.
It's a really good team. McDaniels is good. Anthony Edwards is on his way to superstardom. Cat has been good for the year. Gobert has been really good. This team is just gelling together. Obviously, the concern now and in the future is their money. But this team is really good. I didn't expect them to get off to this hot of a start, and they're proving a lot of people wrong.
Naz Reid coming off the bench.
Naz Reid as a third big man.
Mike Conley, still, like they're a pretty deep team.
A vet point guard that can run your offense for you.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a really good team. Is there anything else you want to touch on?
No, that's the team that I have my eye on right now.
Nice. Oscar?
Do you want me to go next?
Yeah, go ahead.
I guess should I pick a good and a bad team?
Or you could pick just one.
Oh, just one? Okay. So I guess I was going to talk about I don't know. It's either going to talk about how good the Thunder are or how bad the Bulls have been. I guess, I don't know. Let me start in Chicago. I don't know.
Start with the Bulls, and then you could get
to
the Thunder.
Yeah, if we have enough time, I don't know. You can go before me. But I think, I don't know, I'm just confused by this Bulls team because are they trying? Because the team is built like it's trying to win.
A team.
But they're doing a really bad job at it, you know?
The LaVine-DeRozan match does not work.
There's no defense. No,
Vucevic does nothing for
them. Yeah, there's no defense in there, man, from anyone.
Go ahead.
But that's, I don't know, I'm just like really confused because it's like, you know, it's funny, we were just kind of talking about the Jets, and I know it's a different sport, but we're kind of talking about these teams that are just stuck, you know, where it's like they have some good pieces, but they're also not really, you know, rebuilding, and they're not tanking, and they're not trying to get in young players who they can, you know, get the most out of. And I think that bodes pretty bad for fans in the Windy City. You know what I mean? I don't know. It's just like the chemistry on this that team is just terrible.
It is beyond time for them to blow that team up. And I think it's going to happen at the trade deadline.
Yeah, they're trading LaVine.
Yeah.
You have to at this point.
Yeah.
You definitely have to trade
Caruso, LaVine. DeRozan. Like they can get a ton of value for all those pieces.
Do you think they trade DeRozan or Vucevic? Because I feel like they're just going to keep one of them.
Yeah.
I feel like it's going to be tough to trade Vucevic, though.
LaVine's gone.
Yeah, LaVine's definitely gone. Caruso's probably gone, too.
Caruso would be an extremely valuable player on like any championship
team off the bench.
Yeah, so they're going to get a ton of picks for these guys. But that's the question. Who stays?
All right. Because I feel like when LaVine gets traded, it's going to be him and Caruso in a package deal.
Yeah, I can see that.
Yeah. If I'm any other team, I'd preferably have DeRozan because he's still good, whereas Vucevic is just, he's a 15 and 10 guy, cool, but doesn't really add value to your team.
Yeah.
The Magic won that trade when they traded him away. So, yeah. Do you want to touch on the Thunder real quick?
I guess I don't have too much to say other than just I'm really surprised that they're this good this soon. I mean, we've been saying for a long time that they're a team to watch and they're a team that will be good soon. But, I mean, I don't know. And it's still very early in the season, let's say that. You know, we've barely played a tenth of the games, you know, or like an eighth of the game. So there's still a lot of basketball left to be played. But I'm just kind of loving what I see from this team. You know, I don't get to watch as many Thunder games as I want living in New York, you know, out here on the East Coast. They don't show a lot of them. So I just kind of rely on highlights I see on Instagram and YouTube. Mm-hmm. But everything I see is really good, man. I think, you know, we could see a competitive Thunder team again pretty soon.
Yeah, SGA is fantastic. Chet Holmgren has really come onto his own this last week.
SGA took over in that game overtime, against the Warriors.
Yeah,
man.
And in that game against the Warriors, Chet Holmgren, 36-10-5.
Yeah.
Looking
game tying
like,
shot at the buzzer. I mean,
a turnaround too, off with inbound from Giddy with 1.5 left.
They're going to be a really interesting
this team.
This
team's very good.
Yeah.
This team has playoff potential now. Like
for sure,
deep playoff potential.
Oh yeah.
Not just like a first round exit whoever they play in the first round.
The West is interesting, man. Yeah. The West is going to be real interesting.
It's a lot. There's a lot of good teams here.
Yeah, because other than Denver, there's not really that many teams that stand clearly better than everyone else. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, it could be a real dogfight.
And Denver's lost their last two also, so they're 9-4 now. All right, but a team that I'm going to have my eye on the rest of the way here is the Golden State Warriors.
Okay.
Because what a mess. 6-8, Draymond suspended for 5 games. Klay Thompson is beyond washed at this point. Andrew Wiggins, a really slow start to the season, had 31 Saturday in that overtime loss to the Thunder. So hopefully he gets it going. But to me, it just seems like Steph Curry and nothing else.
Yeah, they're entirely reliant on Steph.
Yeah, entirely reliant on Steph because no one else could get anything going. A lot of their guys, Moses Moody, Jonathan Kuminga, like they have a lot of young guys who haven't really done much because they didn't get the opportunity to yet.
I feel like they were hoping that Kuminga would make that next step this season.
I think so too. I think they're really hopeful that Kuminga could, and he hasn't yet. Kevon Looney, he's a solid big man, good rebounder, good defender, but you can't really rely on him either. And it just seems like this team is at the end of the road. You know, they won their championships. I feel like this is the last season they're just starting to realize, this is it.
Yeah. The window is finally closed for the Warriors.
It's closed because teams above them, the Kings have also been really good. Thunder, T-Wolves, like we mentioned, the Nuggets, the Mavs are off to a nice start. It just seems like there's so many good teams above them.
They're old. I mean, they're just really old, man.
They're old
now we're seeing these young teams, Kings, Thunder, like this is the next generation of basketball.
And there's no way that you could give Klay Thompson an extension this summer.
No.
And Max, we talked about this briefly off air. This is why Bob Myers left, I think. He saw that it was coming to an end, but he didn't want to be the one to end it.
The Klay situation. Yeah. I mean, you're putting his jersey up in the rafters.
Yeah.
And it's going to be a sad way for him to leave. You know, a pretty anticlimactic way for one of your franchise pieces to
two straight years coming off of injury. It's tough, but it's time.
Very few athletes ever really get to call game on their own career, you know? That's usually how they go out, unfortunately.
You know, and this team, talent-wise, will never tank.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But they're not going to be good enough to compete.
Yeah, Steph would definitely not stand that. Honestly, these past few years of Steph is, like, to me, some of the most impressive years of his career. He's really just putting the whole team on his back.
He's getting older and even better.
Yeah. It's crazy.
And this season, he's off to a fantastic start. Mm-hmm. But the rest of this team is just a bunch of nothing.
Nah, not good. That's also the thing about... I saw like some people talking about, like, oh, has Andrew Wiggins fallen off? I don't really think so. I think that when they won the last championship... Yeah. He was still doing. He was only a little bit better than how he was before on all the other teams. Just that he was
That Celtics series, right? Yeah, he really stepped up that Celtics series. He was their second best player behind Steph, and he was off to this really slow start. He finally got it going Saturday night. We'll see if it continues. I know they're playing tonight. I don't know who off the top of my head, but it'll be interesting to see what happens.
Rockets.
Yeah, they're playing the Rockets tonight. Yes, Rockets another good team.
Surprisingly,
Ime really got this team playing well. Fred VanVleet got going, Jalen Green, Sengun, you know, really showing promise here. So it's just for the Warriors, they're just stuck, you know. There's so many teams younger and better than them that it's like, where do you go from here? What do you do? You know, it's over.
Mm-hmm.
It's the Warriors as we've known it is done, and I don't think they'll never trade. Steph is a Warrior lifer.
Time of death.
Yeah. Klay is gone. Draymond, you paid him $100 million because you didn't want to pay Jordan Poole, or because you punched Jordan Poole and you decided to keep Draymond instead of Jordan Poole. But it just seems like Draymond, another one, he's a hothead.
Mm.
It, like, you can't trust him.
No words for Draymond, man.
It's okay, just real quick, because you never covered that Gobert thing, right? McDaniels and Klay are going at it, right? They're tugging at it. Their jerseys, right? They're going at it. Gobert just goes over to de-escalate the situation. I understand he kind of pulled Klay away. So he's the only one to de-escalate. It's not like he's going in Klay's face or in any other Warriors teammate face to escalate the situation even further. Draymond comes from the other side of the court and puts him in a chokehold.
Yeah. Drags
him across the court while Karl Anthony Towns is just standing there in front of Draymond and Gobert with his hands up. Yeah. Like, not knowing what to do. Yeah. Like, bro, help your teammate. Your team is getting choked out here.
I love Gobert during that whole exchange. He's just like, why are you doing this?
Like, his hands are off like Draymond.
He just looks so confused the whole time.
I mean, there's history of them, you know, a lot. Like, over that Defensive Player of the Year, that Gobert one that Draymond says he didn't deserve, and then all-star comments that Draymond said, where Draymond said Gobert didn't deserve to be an all-star. So there's been beef between them brewing up to that, but it just seemed like Gobert did nothing wrong. There was no reason for Draymond to do that. Draymond can't even excuse it as he thought Gobert was going to do something. No, he just saw it as an opportunity to attack Gobert, and Gobert made interesting comments where he's like, Draymond doesn't want to play when Steph doesn't play, which is honestly true. Yeah. Because the year that the Warriors were tanking and Steph got hurt, he injured his hand, he was out for the year, Draymond was playing some the worst basketball of his career. So there's some truth to that, and it's just like, for this Warriors team, there's nowhere for them to go, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You have Steph the rest of the way until he retires, and then you just have another bunch of young pieces, which now you finally get the time to develop, because, you know, young players don't develop on championship teams, and now you get the chance to develop them, and we'll see what happens.
Yeah, just let the last guys walk, try and get whatever trade value you can from whatever veteran that isn't Steph, and just... I don't know. While you still have Steph, just, you know, try and get some young players in, and, like, you know, just go again maybe one more time. You just knock on wood and pray for that, you know?
Let's, real quick, before the show ends, let's do some Monday Night Football.
Oh, yes.
We got a Super Bowl rematch, baby. Philadelphia Eagles at the Kansas City Chiefs. Ooh. This is going to be a great game, guys. I'm so excited for this one.
It's going to be fun.
These are two teams that are
And go ahead, to add on that, the Kelce brothers, Travis Kelce and Jason Kelce, will go head to head.
That's right.
Very true.
That's right. Taylor Swift will be in attendance, which means I'm putting my money on the Chiefs tonight. I don't know about you guys.
I think the Chiefs will win. This is gonna be a close one, though.
I think so too. I think the Chiefs will win. I don't know. I can see them just kind of be, you know, really wanting to just, you know, stick it to them one more time.
Do you guys want to do final score predictions?
I think it's going to be high scoring. I'm going to go 27-35. 35-27. Yeah, 35-27
okay.
Chiefs.
Okay. Oscar?
I think 20, I don't know, let's say 27 to 17 Kansas City.
I'll go 28-23 Kansas City.
Okay.
Yeah. This can be a good one.
Wait, we all picked the Chiefs?
Yeah, we all picked the Chiefs.
Oh,
yeah.
Shit. You know what that means.
Yeah. Oh, the Eagles, guys, the Eagles are going to lose.
I mean, I could see that happening, just like just the revenge game, you know?
And the Eagles balled them out.
Yeah, imagine.
Dude, every single pick I've had on this show is wrong.
Every time we predict Monday Night Football specifically.
Yeah.
Every time.
I don't want the Eagles to win, man. Yeah. I can't have that happen. Should I pick the Eagles then? you know what I'm doing? I'm doing it. I'm picking the Philly.
Okay.
Who's favored in this game, by the way? Do we know the line?
Mastermind strategy there, Max.
Yeah.
Picker.
I'm not going to check.
And we've got class with Damien tomorrow, so, you know.
I'm picking the Eagles to win on the road. Big win. Eagles 9-1 going into Thanksgiving. Go Birds, baby.
Okay. All right. Thank you guys for listening to today's show. We'll be back next week talking more NFL and NBA. Happy Thanksgiving, everyone.
All right, have a great Thanksgiving, guys.